go. Jamie Bamber from Battlestar Galactica. Let him know you're happy to see him.
Well, it kept me out of this room for 3 days, and finally I got you all up here. I probably met each and every one of you 2 or 3 times, and you probably asked me 2 or 3 questions, so I'm not sure what there is left to say, but I'm thrilled to be here. I've had a great time in Phoenix. And this is always my favorite part of these conventions. I love the dialogue that we can all have together, a group discussion. So what I really enjoy is hearing your questions, your thoughts, and bouncing stuff back on them, and then I'll ramble on for ages and hopefully crack a few jokes while I do it. But I've had a great weekend, and let's just get going. Let's just ask a few questions and let's get this conversation. Hey, that's better.
Much better.
Wow. Were you all here for the Star Trek panel that just was on?
Woo!
How was that? They're a nice bunch. We went for a curry. I went for a curry with them the other night. They included me in their fabulous world. And they're a super bunch of people, I've got to say. What a nice bunch. And there's, I mean, I'm here alone. My Battlestar family didn't come with me, so I feel like a bit of an orphan.
We're your Battlestar family.
You are my Battlestar family, correct. The right answer. Correct. And by the way, instead of signing back down there, if any of you have left and haven't had a signature and want one, because I've got to rush off to the airport, we're going to do it right here afterwards. I've got all the photos and all that kind of junk. So anything you want, you can lighten my load so that Southwest Airlines don't sting me with a surcharge, okay? I'm doing myself a favor. Right, first question. Lady in gray. I think it's you, the front. Yeah, come on.
I'm asking this on behalf of my husband who's working tech support today, so he couldn't be here. But he wanted to know, I understand that you have family that are American, and so that accent comes to you pretty naturally. Is there any time when that slips in accidentally?
What, in my life?
Yes.
Not really, I mean, sort of, because I live in America, and sometimes when I'm in a restaurant, I say things like, I'd love a glass of water. And the waitress would just look at me with a blank look on her face, and then I have to adjust and say, I'd like a glass of water. And then they get it. And it always reminds me of a story that my eldest daughter, Isla, who will be 9 next week, congratulations, Isla, wherever you are, I know you are. She's I'm very proud to say, bilingual. In the most useless way. And she goes to school, she's entirely American, she comes home, she's entirely British. And once when she was 3, when she was entirely American, we hadn't ever lived in London together, she was going to bed and she said, Daddy, could I have a glass of water? And I said, Isla, there's a D in water. And she thought for a second and said, Daddy, can I have some tea in my water? And she likes a cup of tea, does Isla, so yeah, welcome to my world. We're sort of caught in an Anglo-American hybrid universe. And the other thing that happens to me occasionally is I do voiceovers, and they always want a mid-Atlantic accent, which I have no idea, you know, what that is. Somewhere in Madeira or the Azores, perhaps. It's like Portuguese English. I don't know where the mid-Atlantic people live. Most of them, I would thought, are drowned. And I always struggle with that accent when I need to do it, but I think I do have a kind of mid-Atlantic thing going on when I have to make myself understood. But that's, good question.
Hey. As far as the show's writing, was there anything that totally surprised you when you read the script? Or what I guess was the most surprising thing that ever happened to you?
Well, I remember the first wow moment. I mean, there were so many, but when the penny first dropped that we were sort of holding a less than flattering mirror up to our Western society. And the first moment of that was when I suddenly realized that these Cylons were talking about monotheism in a way that really, could be, in the Christian, Judeo-Christian world, the way most of us talk about our God, and they're the bad guys. And I just thought that was so bold on American television, which normally is so careful not to offend its audience. And Ron and the writers were just sort of brazen about trying to make us examine ourselves and have a good look at ourselves you know, and then the other moment, the other famous moment was when the sympathetic characters turned into suicide bombers at the same time that we were in Iraq, and obviously we were facing a lot of that. And you know, great drama has always been about putting you, the audience, in a position to believe something that is the opposite of what you actually believe, so that you can experience life through someone else's eyes. And I don't think we do that enough as people. And drama started as a sort of quasi-religious Greek sort of ritual. And drama's become very kind of, you know, it's become entertainment, and we don't really think of it very seriously anymore, but it's there for a real serious purpose, which is to empathize with someone that you otherwise would not empathize with. And I think our show did that almost better than any other show. You know, you found yourself rooting for Cylons against human beings at certain points. And, you know, that's really powerful. And I don't think it's any secret that, you know, a lot of right-wing sort of political viewpoint audience members found a lot that they agreed with in the show. At the same time, the very liberal, very left-wing, you know, socialists found, you know, lots that they could, and everyone thought the show was sort of broadcasting their point of view, which I think is so clever, and they, you know, these guys managed to pull that off. The wow moments for me were tend to be those moments where you had this shiver of, oh my God, I can't believe Ron just did that, and he did it so many times.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi there, Ron. Thank you for coming to Phoenix. You're quite awesome.
Oh, bless you. So are you. Great voice. Oh, my God.
Thank you. You know, you're like the fifth person to say that. I'm going up to the voice acting workshop right after this panel.
Yeah, you can teach them a thing or two.
Right. Well, right. Now, I have...
Movie trailers. You could do really good movie trailers.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jamie Bamber.
There you go. Thank you.
Okay, so I have... it's kind of a complicated question, and it's kind of dark. If you want something a little lighthearted, I also have one of those.
As my friend Edward James Olmos would say, hit me with the dark.
Okay. At the Battlestar finale, right, a lot of stuff has happened peripheral to your character. Your wife blows her own head off, as a Leonidas' wife. And the love of your life disappears without a trace. And my question is, what possible motivation, despite having escaped the Cylons, would your character have for going on this planet when your character literally has lost everything?
Yeah, I know. Rude, right?
It's very rude.
I mean, the first one, where we are on a great date, everyone's happy, feeling good, bit of a rapprochement after some marriage issues, and say goodbye, perfectly satisfying kiss, good night. She walks into her bedroom and blows her head off. Yeah. No, I think the overwhelming message from the show is just how amazingly resilient human beings are, and how, yes, we have hearts, yes, we bleed when we are, you know, cut, and it hurts. But we have this amazing, amazingly noble and capacity for dignity, and to make sense of nonsense. And if the show was about anything, it was about the human ability to create sense out of nonsense. And you know, I suppose Lee, better than most, was able to do that. You know, he holds himself together when all around him, those that he loves are disappearing and dying, and questioning him and all the rest of it. And, you know, he's tough in that way, tougher than Starbuck, who appears all, you know, swagger and the perfect Viper pilot, and you know, never lets anything get to her. But of course, you know, she's doesn't have the tools to deal with her fragility and her worries about her own identity and all the rest of it. You know, Lee actually does. Lee's had to question himself his whole life. She never did. She was in the right milieu for herself. You know, she was born to do what she was doing, and Lee was born into a life that he questions from day one. So I think, you know, with Lee's marriage choices and then not going so well, and the unfortunate incident of the suicide after a great final date, you know, he's able to put that together. And the ending for me was beautiful, because Ron chose to do the one thing that it is always resonant, which is going back to the start. And there's a show like Battlestar with the refrain, you know, all this has happened before and all this will happen again. The way he was able to, like a good symphony, you know, bring it round and have you sort of with the same musical motifs that we opened the whole saga with. And you see the people from beginning to end, you see the same people. They've been on this crazy ass journey, but they're able to be dignified human beings, the successful ones. And those are the ones that survived and ended up on that planet and making educated choices about the way they wanted to live their lives in peace, hopefully, from then on. What's the dumb question? Come on, funny one.
I was actually wondering if I could take a picture of you and text it to my friend who's, she's currently reading 50 Shades of Grey. She wants something nice to look at.
You may well fold your arms after asking that question. I know the book of which you speak. I know, this is salacious. Go ahead.
Thank you very much.
Holding my mic.
Story, right? When you go to the next question.
Yeah, I will be.
Hi, Jamie.
I'm going to do that again.
I have to tell you, before I tell you my question, my favorite thing to do to people is who've never seen Battlestar Galactica is show them the entire series, or at least the movie.
What do you do to them? Kidnap them?
Wait, no.
That's 77 hours worth of life.
No, it's cool. I make them watch it because they'll be like, I don't get it. I was like, just watch it, please. And look at Lee, he's cool. Majority of my female friends go, yeah, he's really cool, I get it. And I say, you know he's British, right? And their eyes go like, prove it. So I get the interviews out. So hopefully that'll get you more fans. For those of you wanting to introduce your friends to it, that's a really great way to do it. But my question actually is about your work on Law & Order UK. Which was like a confluence of all fabulously sci-fi nerdy things, because there's you, and then there's Rima Agumon, and now we have a Doctor Who on it.
That's right.
Yes, now we have Boba Fett too. But coming from Battlestar Galactica and going to Law & Order UK, did you find the storytelling differences a bit abrupt to go to? Because even though we all speak English, it is a different sense in the UK from how they tell their stories versus how we do it here in North America.
That wasn't a real, that's what attracted me to it, was part of going back to the UK with the great American iconic show like Law & Order. And because that had never been done before. I mean, Americans remake a lot of British product, but the reverse never happens because we just consume the original American product without having to sort of adapt it to our own cultural context because we're quite familiar with yours. That was an attraction, but storytelling-wise, I think it was very much in the mode of the American show. We just had some cultural nuances which were a bit different, which I'm obviously quite familiar with, so that wasn't really an issue. The big change for me was from doing serialized TV to very episodic procedural TV, and how dry that is, and how sort of, like, one of the great joys of being on Battlestar Galactica was getting a brown envelope with a new script in it, and wondering where the story's gonna go. I mean, before Battlestar, I'd never done any more than 8 episodes, I didn't think of anything. So you kind of knew where the character was going to go before you started. The beautiful thing about Battlestar is like reading a really long novel over many months, and you'd look forward to going to bed so you could, you know, read the next chapter, and you didn't know where this character was going to go, that you would live it out. And then by the end, of course, you had all these memories, real memories, of living out all the past experience of this character. You didn't have to... You know, when you do a movie, you create a backstory for yourself, you imagine it, you sort of try and make it as real as possible. But we didn't have to do that with Battlestar, because I'd actually been there. I stood there. I committed mutiny, and I remember what it felt like. I was thrown in jail. I remember what that felt like. I was slapped by a girl, punched by a girl with a clenched fist. Remember what that felt like. So it was all real. And with Law & Order, every episode is a hermetically sealed, you know, beginning to end, tell the story. It's much more of a producer's medium than an actor's medium, because, you know, Brad and I, who I love to death. He's a very funny, he's a comedian first and foremost, so he had us laughing all day long, and he made the show fun, but the actual scenes are very repetitive, and I never had to learn a scene, very rarely learn a scene before going to set that day, because the questions were all pretty obvious about where were you between the hours of X and Y, when did you last see Z, and how did that make you feel? The challenge of the show was actually creating a humanity with Brad, which was very largely non-verbal. You know, the shtick with him eating all the time and me rolling my eyes and whatever it was. So it's a completely different challenge. You know, Battlestar was this epic, sprawling saga where one week you'd be in some triangular love affair hell, the next week you'd be in jail, the next week you'd be flying the Viper courtroom, president, whatever it was, boxing matches. Law and Order was in a suit in an office, walking down the roads, asking people questions. So, and it never really changed. So it's a tough one to keep fresh. But I had a great co-star, so that really made it special.
Cool. Just one follow-up. My two favorite things about Battlestar was Roland Lampkin and you and your interaction. And I got a hug from Mark Shepard. I was wondering if I could get one from you.
Aww. Absolutely. Do you want to see? Oh, I have to jump down.
You
could. Oh, it's like jeans.
I went shopping in New York at the Upfronts last week and went into Diesel and came up with these things which are basically sprayed on.
Speaking of microphone gags, I told you the story about Aaron Douglas in the suit a few days ago.
Oh, yes, you did.
But anyone didn't see Aaron Douglas' panel last year, go to YouTube and you'll see what that was. But anyhow, I love to hear stories from on set, funny gags, pranks, whatnot. What's memorable moments in that regard?
Oh my god. One of the funniest, but it was sort of not really the set, but some of you will know that actually when we were shooting, NBC Universal was owned by General Electric. And as such, we came under General Electric's sort of corporate policies on sexual harassment and the like. And the thing about a film set is, you know, it's very co-ed. So there's men, women doing all sorts of different jobs, dressed in all sorts of different ways, often shooting risque scenes where people are almost naked, lying next to each other in a bed or whatever. So, you know, sexuality is kind of sort of everywhere. And they showed us this video, which was from a factory floor somewhere, probably in Cleveland, with these guys in hard hats, looking at the one female on the assembly line. And the guy's like taking out his, "Hey, you like my banana?" And provocatively peeling a banana. And then there was a big video, and these NBC brass were up there very seriously, all the lawyers and stuff, making sure we paid attention to the guy going, "You're in my banana." And then, of course, in the front row is Olmos with a big banana. taking the piss out of this whole thing. And, of course, the NBC brass can't tell Edward James Olmos off. But he stands up, turns to everyone, "Anybody want my banana?" And that's Eddie, you know, he's such a jokester, like nobody really realises how, but at the same time, you know, he understands that this is a serious issue, but it's just a great example of the massive corporate world just not understanding the difference in nuance between one workplace and another, where, where we were just hugely co-ed and everything that we do is sort of male, female, blah, 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 and we're all quite comfortable with it, but there are still boundaries, but that's not the way maybe to educate us with hard hats and assembly lines.
Thank you.
Hi, Jamie. I have a more serious question. Hopefully this won't be too much of a downer. There was one particular episode of Battlestar that really stuck out for me, and it was, I believe it was second season, you were involved with a prostitute who also had a daughter.
Yeah.
And you went down into the hells of the black market areas and ended up killing a mafia boss over the child prostitution that was going over.
Wonderful pricey, by the way.
I was just wondering, the first part of the question is basically,
that was definitely, to me at least, it was one of the darker episodes. So I was wondering what it was like doing that episode, you know, amongst all the other dark stuff. but then also, especially as a parent, how that affected you and what you brought to it.
You know, I really enjoyed doing the episode because part of the battle, the ongoing, not battle, but the ongoing sort of thing that I struggled with a bit with the Adama is to avoid the Boy Scout thing, because, you know, he is kind of the clean-cut ideal of service and duty and all this sort of stuff, even though he feels in the wrong skin and you can see that he's got issues with his own upbringing and the like. So, you know, the writers and I were always quite keen to sort of surprise the audience and show him in a different light, and I thought it was really cool to... The wonderful thing about Galactica is you think you're seeing everything that goes on in the fleet week in, week out, but of course, it's 50,000 people, of which we're following maybe 20. So it's lovely when we got to little corners, other corners of this ramshackle fleet and saw what was really going on, and I just thought it was great that Lee was having this sort of strangely honorable but slightly sordid affair with a prostitute and paying her, but also feeling some sort of duty to this child. So it encapsulated Lee really well, I thought, which is that, yes, he's a human being, he's not perfect, and yet he's still, even though he does something which many people wouldn't agree with, he's trying to do it in the most sort of honest and chivalrous way that he knows how to do. And, you know, these are strange situations, you know, with the end of the world, and the one person that he should be with is the last person that he's with and all the rest of it. So and I love that this was going on while you're watching all the other episodes. You know, this is a sort of background episode that you haven't been party to. So, I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed the playing of it. I don't think it's the greatest episode that we did. You know, the whole child slavery thing is so dark, and I'm not sure we really acknowledged how dark, you know, that sort of goings on in the fleet would be. But I loved the attempt. You know, the great thing about our show is we tried everything. We tried to do a bit of everything. And some of the episodes really sing, and some of them, you know, clunk along and aren't perfect. I'd say that was probably one of them, but it was a great, you know, we weren't scared. We weren't scared.
Clunks along and isn't perfect, kind of like the Battlestar.
It's an old clunker that we make do with.
And so just the other part about coming to that episode as a parent.
Oh, as a parent, yeah. Oh, as a parent.
Did you connect to? Was that hard? Or?
Always. You know, as a parent, my abiding memory of becoming a parent is suddenly being opened to a world of terror. You know, you have this sort of immediate kind of expansion of your heart that happens, but with that comes immense capacity for pain and suffering, and it's hopefully just potential suffering. You know, you hope it's never really realized, and you know, one thing as an actor is you sort of do realize it in the imagining of certain situations that you then have to play out. And since I've become a parent, I've played lots of parents having to go through horrible things, and it's sort of easy to do, to tap into that, and you're just having, you know, you come in and out of it, and you're very grateful at the end of it that it isn't actually your reality, but I get us to face those things, and I think all parents do in the darker moments.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Hi, Jamie. I am just as honored to be in your presence as I'm sure you are to be in mine.
I'm extremely humbled by your disembodied head.
No big deal. They're going to green screen this later. It's cool.
What are you going to look like?
Brad Pitt.
Oh!
I've already got the face, it's just the body.
Okay.
Nice.
In which movie?
I'm sorry?
In which movie?
Thelma and Louise.
Oh, Thelma and Louise? Okay. I thought you might go for Benjamin Button.
Which part?
At the end, of course.
Anyway. I'm actually in the middle of Battlestar Galactica right now for the first time. I'm in season two. I've got like 3 episodes to go left in season 2, so I haven't seen it all yet. But my question is, I guess, other than the rumors I've heard of a fat suit, what
people are telling you that? point them out. I want to... Oh, the fat ones. Okay.
Other than that, what's something like awesome that happens with your character in the last two seasons that I can like look forward to?
So you want me to ruin it for you? I won't ruin it. I'll elliptic it. The last two seasons, almost everything happens to him. I mean, he foregoes his Viper, his uniform, his Battlestar twice. Ends up in a courtroom, at odds with the president. What else does he do? Well, you know, loses a wife. Carelessness. Then loses a would-be wife. Through no fault of his own, because she doesn't actually exist.
So nothing good happens to
him. And he's a Cylon, sorry.
Thank you.
Hello again.
Hello again.
Good to see you.
First off, I'd like to thank you again for coming here. And having had met you down at your booth, you are literally one of the most genuine people I've met, which is really nice. Yeah, for sure. Super humble, which is a great guy. So, my question for you is: was there a character when you were watching, you know, the show or going through it that, I mean, I know you're a little biased towards Liadama, but maybe someone else that you really enjoyed seeing?
Yeah, almost everybody, but the actor that I always single out is Michael Hogan, who played Colonel Ty. Yeah. Michael is. He's one of these guys where, you know, directors occasionally would apologize for getting us to do another take or to do something again. And he'd go, you kidding me? I'm an actor, it's what I do, I love it, let's do more, let's do this again. And he was just, you know, he's a very well respected stage actor in Canada. That was a terrible impression of Michael Hogan, which I've never tried to do before, I apologize. But he's a wonderful, wonderful actor that would say things like, you know, his character's an alcoholic, and he said, I wanted to do, how did he put it? He wanted to honor the addiction, or something like that. He doesn't view human people as problems. He sort of venerates their flaws and treats them with respect. And he brought such, that erect sort of backbone and spine that character is desperately trying to hold on to despite being a completely broken man all the way through from beginning to end and all the awful things that happened to him. And that desperate, clenched jaw dignity that he's trying to hold on to, I just thought was fantastic. And then, of course, there's the laugh, sort of halfway to a Count Dracula on Sesame Street. I can't even remember, it's been so long since I watched it, but that laugh just cracked us all up every time he did it. It'd read through whenever it was. He's a lovely man, he's married to a lovely lady, and yeah, great people. And it's a role that, you know, could have been a nothing role. The best friend of the commander who, you know, is slightly a stickler for military form, and, you know, but he turned it into something truly, truly sublime, I thought. Wonderful actor.
If you'd indulge me one more.
Absolutely.
Thank you. How much sway did you and the other actors have over your character's roles? I know that you said it was more of a serious thing, so could you kind of talk to the writers, and did you have any...
More and more as it went on, you know, we all became very good friends and we respected each other, and there was no sense in which writers felt that we were sort of trampling on their toes when we had ideas. And there were many moments where I would question things. The transitions, Lee had so many transitions, and I was just making sure each transition was right. They would ask me, do you feel the lawyer, freedom, politician thing is interesting? And I would say yes, for this reason. And I suppose the biggest practical input that I ever had was that speech, the lawyer's sort of, whatever it was, 10-8 minutes on the stand.
In the
end of season 3. Oh, cool.
And
Mark Verheiden wrote this lovely speech, which was maybe 30 lines long. It wasn't that long. And because I've been living this, and it was a fight with the writers, because I did feel Lee, because he's sort of an old-fashioned kind of hero, if he is a hero, and Starbucks, the much more Han Solo hero that everyone seems to love these days, the sort of disrespecter of authority, and Lee's very much, he has issues with authority, but he doesn't stick his neck on the line in an FU kind of a way. It's more of a sort of deferential, he worked his way through it very much meticulously, and that's not so sort of lustered after these days in terms of our hero worship. So I was always fighting his corner, and then this opportunity came in this courtroom to defend the character that he despises the most, just to show, just to sort of make the point that we're all stuck in this imperfect world, all trying to make our best, but we're all flawed, we're all screwed, we've all done things that are terrible, and it's not acceptable to make some one person a scapegoat and the bogeyman to make us all, the rest of us, feel good. And I felt so passionately about this speech, and I said, look, like this, what Mark's done is very writerly and elusive, but I feel like really hammering it here. I feel like this is the character he can hold it in no more, and he's going to tell everyone what he really thinks. So I went away and I came up with ideas and I wrote it, and Michael Ryan, the director, said, just surprise us, just say what, whatever it is you want to say. So the back sort of 60% of what ended up on screen was me, and there were moments like that, and the writers, the producers, the directors were really encouraging, and it all stayed in there, which is incredible in television. To speech started, turn the page, speech still going, turn the page, speech still going, turn the page, speech still going. I've never seen that in a television script before. It disobeys every rule of an audience's attentive span. And it sort of worked, and that was just an instance where, you know, we really could get involved, and Ron Moore and his team were such good writers that they trusted themselves to encourage our involvement and to trust themselves to edit it when it was positive, you know, and not use it when it was negative. So it was great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I have a question. When you first started the series, how long did it take you guys to figure out just how spectacular the show really was going to be?
That's a great question. There were little mini moments. When I first got the script, I sort of squeezed my butt cheeks together and went, "Oh, why?" And then I read the script, and I couldn't. And I was told I was going up for this character Apollo, and I couldn't find him. I saw this lead, this Kara, and I was like, "There's no Apollo. Wait a minute." And then it was in a speech, "Apollo, Apollo!" Someone shouting, and it was a Kara character saying. So I couldn't quite work out what my memory of Galactica was in relation to this thing, and my memory was very hazy. I remembered the capes and the boots and the three buttons on the joystick and the zooming out of that triangle into space. I remembered all that, but I didn't really remember the dynamic of the characters. So I thought, look, this is a gig. It's a good gig. They're paying me half decently. It's 4 hours. We'll go and have fun. We'll see what it's like. And, you know, I've got nothing else to do. So off we went. And then they cast Eddie and Mary, and the sets were amazing. We did this boot camp. Suddenly things started slotting in, and Eddie in particular, sort of, remember the first day we went to the set, he walked in, and we were all there, all the cast, and the designer, the artistic director, was very proudly showing us, like, you know, this is the CIC. God, I can't even remember names like CIC anymore, it's been that long ago. And then he would go, "We're gonna F this up, right? All of this, we're gonna make, knock the edges off that, dirty on the walls, make everything dented. I want to mess this whole thing up. This is an old Battlestar, it's not a new Battlestar." When you have someone with that kind of conviction, I'm sure Richard Hudelin, who's a wonderful designer, was going to do that anyway, but it was just that sense of which everyone was involved, and Eddie was really passionate. He wasn't, because I thought, okay, these Oscar-nominated actors are going to be up here in Vancouver doing sci-fi, you know, sort of waiting until they could get home in the evening and get out of this, you know, goofiness and go back to their prestigious work elsewhere. It was not the case. They took it so seriously. Eddie said to me, "I'm going to watch every daily. Every scene you are in, I'm watching you." And I thought I was going to get fired anyway, because here was I, a white-skinned, blue-eyed, Irish, British, boy trying to play his barrio son, and I thought, oh, I am so fired. And then I heard that Eddie had an actor son called Bodie, and I was like, and he's coming to Vancouver. I thought, it's done. It's already been done. He's had a word. they've looked at this camera tests, they've gone, not going to work, let's lose the guy with no film credits. So I was terrified of Eddie, and he was like, you got to be in the accent all the time. All the time. And I was like, okay, I'll try. I mean, okay, I'll try. But and I can't do it. I can't do it all day. I can't just turn it on. So it was at that point you started taking it seriously, and there were scenes with Eddie and Michael. Reimer is a very independent film kind of guy. I'd never done television where the actors were invited to talk to the director about what worked and what didn't, and what their opinion of the script was. I'd never encountered that before. You know, your expectations lift. Then it airs, it does spectacular numbers, you get excited. After all the death threats and like, you've changed right. up into a girl, and how dare you trample on the greatest piece of art the late 70s ever gave to you. And all your friends emailing you all this stuff, saying, you're dead, man, you're so in trouble. I don't know what you're doing over there, but watch out, your back has a big target on it. And that whole thing, I was paranoid. So we get through the miniseries, it does spectacular numbers, and then they don't pick it up for like 3 months, right until the deadline. So I was out to dinner in London, and it was 8 o'clock London time, so what's that, 4 in the morning? Something like that. 1 p.m. in LA. So they're getting to the end of a Friday afternoon where they have to pick us up. And I was with my wife and her sister-in-law and her fiancé, and I was like, well, it looks like that big opportunity in America didn't wash out anyway, blah, blah, blah. Go home, have a few glasses of wine. Go home, head on the pillow, doing that slightly drunken spinning room thing. And then suddenly the phone rings, and it's my agent in LA saying, you know, you're picked up. And I was like, oh, okay, that's cool. Not knowing what to expect. Go to season one, suddenly meet Eddie house hunting. I was in a little house and I walked out, we like this house, walk out and there's Eddie and I'm like, oh shit, not him. I was like, hello Mr. Ron. And he was like, hey, we're a hit. And he gives me this big hug and I'm like, where did this guy come from? What did you do with the scary man? And then, as we started the season, and things like I've already said, the monotheism against the polytheism, just little moments when you realize this was special. And then people in the press, it was really the people in the press. Variety, Rolling Stone, Time Magazine, just saying that this was the best unknown show on TV. And you suddenly just went, oh my God, I'm in one of those shows that everyone's talking about. So say we all. And it got better and better. We got given a Peabody, we got all these awards. We didn't get, Emmys, and everyone was going on about, oh, you didn't get any Emmys. Well, you didn't expect to get any Emmys, but we were really talked about, and people were using the word frack, and there were articles. And I've never been in something that really sort of, especially in this country, really captured a feeling. And, we were at war, newly at war in Iraq, and 9/11, and all this stuff that was really close to all of our hearts. And we were portraying it without being literal. And it made it sing. And people really responded to that. It was the most exciting, working period of my life. And it got better every season. It really did.
Well, I have one more question.
Please.
I don't know the name of the episodes very well, but I think it was called The Dance, which was my
favorite. The boxing.
Yes. Yeah. That was my favorite episode, and I got asked how many punches actually got through.
Well, the fight that Tomo and I did, because Tomo's a pretty accomplished martial artist, and I'd never boxed before Battlestar, but I'd done a lot of boxing training with Alex Pornovic for season one with Eddie and I. We'd go every week for a couple of hours and do some. I got really into it, and so Tomo and I we didn't pull any punches. We were hitting each other, and he's a big guy, and I like that whole physical side of things. So that fight, we weren't trying to knock each other out or anything, but every punch landed, it made a noise. It made that noise, that the air coming out of gloves thing. Every single punch, we knew when they were coming. So you sort of tense up or whatever it is, and if it was to the face, it was pulled slightly, but we made contact every single time, which was really fun. And you were presenting it to everybody else, because we were all in that room, and everyone got their chance, to go up there. This is my fight. It was like being at drama school. Fight night. We had it last night when I was at drama school, where everyone, my fight is with two swords and a saber, and watch this really bit. We had a whole audience there, and we got given certificates at the end of it. It was a bit like that. And we all, brilliant, you know, and everyone got up and did their bit. But I really enjoy fighting with Tommy because, you know, he really knows what he's doing and you can really, you know, it's two guys, so with all due respect to Katie, who's a tough girl, very physical, you know, the last thing I wanted to do was hit Katie so it hurt her or so cut her or whatever, but with Tommy I didn't care. So, it would only improve his looks. So that was a lot of fun. It was a great episode. It really was. You know, another one, an unusual episode that you don't get too often in TV shows, but we could do anything we wanted.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Hey.
Hi again.
It's Maggie, everyone.
Hi.
Maggie's going to be a surgeon, everyone. I'm going to play a surgeon, everyone.
Actually, that's the question I wanted to ask you.
Come on, Maggie.
I wanted to see, because I know you and I were talking earlier about your show, I wanted to know if you can give a bit more description in the setting as to...
I'd love to. To the future, yeah.
Yeah.
I've just been lucky enough to get picked up on a series for David E. Kelly called Monday Mornings, which Sanjay Gupta's novel, which is based on Sanjay Gupta's novel, Monday Mornings at the same title. And it is set in a teaching hospital about a bunch of surgeons. I play a neurosurgeon, super hotshot neurosurgeon, 37 years old, Californian surfer kind of guy, loner, with long hair and a shaggy beard, kind of. And the basic core element of the show is it's based on a thing called morbidity and mortality. And many of you will know what that is, but for those of you who don't, it's a kind of in-house surgeons getting together in a hospital to haul over the coals anybody who's lost someone on the table the previous week or adversely had adverse effects on someone through a surgical procedure going wrong. And the surgeons basically hold each other to account so that they can all learn from mistakes, as you know, we should all do in life and not be sort of defensive about those mistakes. But surgeons being the very ambitious, especially neurosurgeons, sort of quite arrogant, best of the best, they have a Viper Pilot sort of mentality about them, actually. And they have a reputation for, you know, for being slightly full of themselves. They view it as an opportunity sometimes for one-upmanship and to settle scores and to be seen as more prominent than the others within the room. So there's a kind of David Kelly mini kangaroo courtroom drama within the medical theatre of the operating theatre. Wonderful cast, Ving Rhames, Alfred Molina, Bill Irwin, Jennifer Finnegan, Soryu Rao, and others. I'm really excited by it. It's it, the network of it, and we'll see how it goes, but it'll be on TNT in the winter. And I had to do lots of research. I got to see a brain tumor removed from some poor soul's head for 8 hours at UCLA, which was truly awe-inspiring, and every bit as exciting as flying with the Blue Angels, which is what I did when I did Battlestar Galactica. So I've gone from sort of to... yeah, I'm thrilled about it.
Well, thanks, and best of luck.
Thanks,
man. Your new show sounds very interesting.
I promise.
First of all, I gotta say, with all sincerity and without any hyperbole whatsoever, Battlestar Galactica, best show ever. I mean, seriously, any genre, any channel, love it. Writing and acting. I mean, forget about the effects, forget about the, you know, Cylons. The writing and acting, and since you're an actor, I'll ask you about the acting. I was going to ask you about Eddie, but you told a few Eddie stories, and I love it. I mean, feel free to keep it coming. But I'll change it up and ask you about your relationship both on screen and off screen with Mary, because you guys had said, you know, sometimes you were on her side, sometimes Lee was against her. I'm curious to know, since she was, you know, one of the two big movie stars, and it's really a shame that she or Eddie or anybody from that show never won an Emmy for Best Actor. That's absolutely ridiculous. But tell me, I mean, what her energy was like. She's so convincing in her role.
She's probably the single most talented actor I've ever worked with. She's an extraordinary lady. She operates very near the surface. Even just as a human being, you can see her. She's sort of fizzing right beneath the surface. And she's immensely warm-hearted. She's, you know, she's very spiritual. She meditates. She's very in touch. She's got this cool energy about her. But the thing about Mary is I watch her do certain takes, very emotional scenes. There's one where she, I think, is burning, or trying to burn the I don't even remember what it's called, the Book of Cobalt, I think. the Bible of this world. And for her, this book has been everything that she's been following. You know, she believes that she's following some message in this book, and she realizes it's a bunch of hocus, and she's burning it. And I just remember watching behind the monitor, and take one, she was in pieces, obliterated, as she's, you know, burning, his tears flying. Take two, 10% less. Take three, 10% less than that. I mean, just in perfect increments, entirely honest. There's not an ounce of fakery, and Mary's never needed a tear stick or any help to do it. She just, all the gradients so that the director will have every single choice. And yet sometimes she's so canny that she knows not to give too many choices to an editor or a director, because they'll take the ones that she's least maybe happy with. But so she is the most talented actress that I've probably worked with. And then she's also the most maternal, warm, empowering, lovely lady until you play a character that has to cross her. And then for those hours on set, for that day, she's formidable. Like, when I had to spar with her in the quorum, and I was sensing that she'd lost the plot a bit, and as a character, and you know, giving her a hard time and asking her the Prime Minister's type questions that we have in England, where everyone guffaws and hears and tells you to shut up. Suddenly, because we were free to sort of go off script a bit, and I would, and if I did, it was daggers, you know, daggers would be bad. How dare you? Do you know how much I have been there for you over the last 4 years? This subtext all flying at me. And suddenly she unloads with like the best response you could ever. And you just, okay, I don't want to piss her off too much. As Jamie, as Lee, as anyone. So she, you know, and that's why she's a wonderful actress. Very, very tender, but got a steel in her, which is something else. And James Callis always used to tell me this is Balter, because he was clashing with her the whole time. She's like, no, you're really nice, but I tell you what, whew, you don't know the half of it. You don't know the half of it. All day long is a war. And you know, she is that committed to what she does.
Are you familiar at all with Dwight K. Schrute from the American version of The Office?
I forgive me, not.
He's quite a Battlestar Galactic.
Oh yes, is that Rainn Wilson's character?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, I've met Rainn, yeah, yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, he's great. He's so talented. Thanks.
Hey, Jamie, sorry. I just saw an ad on the BBC America the other day promoting you, and I just wondered if you knew in advance, or if you've even seen it.
Well, the Bamber Broadcasting Corporation.
Yeah, yeah. I just wondered if you knew about that in advance, if they asked you.
I didn't know anything about it until I got my friend and publicist Craig Schneider sent me this link. I clicked on it, and it just had this super long montage, which looked to be an unruly piss tape, I thought. I thought, you know, one of you clever people that's handy with Final Cut, just, you know, mock this thing up. And I went, ha ha ha, replied to him. And then I was, sure enough, was watching TV, and it came on. And at that point, I emailed it to my agent in London. I emailed it to everyone, saying, look at this. Because the BBC, to me, is like sacrosanct.
Right, right.
And to somehow wheedle my initials into its sort of titular.
I think they should leave it
acronym. Well, sadly, in the BBC, the real BBC in England, I'm not quite as prominent as I am on BBC America. So in the colonial outpost, that would be cheese. Back on the mothership, not so much. I was in an episode of Outcasts, and that didn't go very far, so I'd love to do more for the beat, but...
Still, stay in the US then.
Oh no, I'm very happy here, don't worry, I'm very happy here. But yeah, it was a real, that was a thrill, real thrill. Hey.
Hi, when you talk about being an old-fashioned hero a lot, that's actually something I really enjoy about your work, whether it's Leodama or...
Yeah,
so I was just wondering, when you're doing something more like everyday heroic, like Lee as a civilian or the detective in Law and Order, how do you get to that point? Because I feel it's very convincing. And is it maybe even based on your own real everyday heroes?
Well, I try not to think too much about heroes because, you know, my take on heroes is the closer you get to them, the less heroic they are. And I think that's true from almost, you know, everyone that we build up in history, from you know, Mother Teresa to Martin Luther King to whoever, JFK, whoever your hero is, you know, you get close enough and you see a human being and they're not perfect. They have moments of complete resilience and moments that you admire, but they also have moments that you don't. So, you know, as an actor, your job is really to, if you're going to create an interesting hero, is to think about the unheroic side of it. Trust that the writers and stuff will take care of making you look heroic enough. And it's really to concentrate on the other stuff. And I guess that's my whole sort of response, is the human side of it. And, you know, with Play a Cop, like Matt Devlin, the key to me was workplace camaraderie and banter. It wasn't about, you know, the being brilliant at the job or anything. It was just creating that relationship with your coworker that we all have. That funny, you know, that moment in the day where we actually genuinely are the funniest people on the planet. For that 1 second where you think, this is the funnest thing I've ever, and the other guy's making you laugh, and you're making them laugh. And we all do it all day long without being stand-up comedians and all the rest of it. And so that was the focus of Law & Order, is capturing that sort of joy of working with someone that you really enjoy working with, regardless of what the job is, and trusting that the job and, you know, the script is going to take care of all that other stuff. So, the more I work, it's those little bits that really excite me, like Monday mornings in all the surgery. It's that sort of black humor that comes with dealing with life and death on a daily basis. And same with it being a cop or whatever you do, you know, you get yourself through the day by trying to make yourself laugh as much as you can. And that's one of the ways that you get yourself through the day. So it's little human things that are important. So, you know, it's only in the cold light of day that you can dwell about things as broad as, you know, what makes a convincing hero and all the rest of it. But the most important thing is to be a convincing human being, and not to play the result, but to sort of just be present in that situation.
That's kind of what I meant about the everyday hero.
Yeah,
you were a person.
Yeah.
Just a Boy Scout.
Well, yeah, you put your finger on it. Yeah, that's exactly right. And I think, you know, if the documentary crew followed Martin Luther King around every day, you'd have seen the same thing, you know. But we only see the big speeches these days, and you know, you see the high points, the big rhetoric. It's actually the other things that make them, you know, interesting as an actor. And when you are an actor, you latch onto that kind of stuff, because that's what really sells a character as a real human being that you want to spend time with.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
Okay, first of all, has anybody else noticed that the ceiling things kind of look like disassembled May stars?
Yeah. That's so funny, because that's dead true. Yeah.
Did that just for you.
That's really scary.
No, it's been creeping me out all day.
And sort of TARDIS suckers.
Yes.
Plunges,
back towards the beginning of the series, when sci-fi, back when it had a real name, realized that, holy crap, this is something good. They did a behind-the-scenes thing.
You don't like Sydney?
No. It, you know, sounds like, well, there are children here. Anyway, I distinctly remember there was a part where James Callis was taking the piss a bit because he got to use his accent and you didn't. And you were talking about how there were certain words that are very hard to say with an American accent that are very much British. And I was wondering if you would say that for us, because I get a kick out of it every time.
What, bugger?
Yes! You can say it with an American accent.
Bugger.
There we go.
Doesn't work.
No, it doesn't.
But the other words, the words that are absurd to me, like, now that I am a fully-fledged American, because I live here now, I'm not just a citizen, so you can't deport me from Arizona, by the way. the words that threw me were things like normalcy, which I had never seen before. That's not a word where I come from. We have a word, and it's normality. So when I would get these words in the script, I'd think they were typos. And the other one was, I'll take it under advisement, which I rang David Icke, the producer, to say, what is this drivel? This, I'll take it under advisement. Advisement? What is advisement? I think I can guess, but you want to do your English A-level again. Or you don't do A-levels in this country. Well, it shows.
Roger Daltrey once said that Americans don't speak any form of the Queen's English, and you pretty much just illustrated
the real point is English is a great language because it's completely anarchic. And, you know, English has ended up as expressive as it is because you can make up new words all the time. Shakespeare did it endlessly. So any Englishman that sort of gives you a hard time, it's very easy to put them back on their place, because a lot of the words that we use every day were invented by John Milton and Shakespeare and all the great writers. And Americans have a wonderful turn of phrase. I mean, everyone here always comments about my accent, and that's lovely, but if you went to London, we'd be commenting about yours. There was a lady from Louisiana today who I could listen to all day long. She had, it was incredible. Like, are you here, by the way? She's gone back to Louisiana, fair enough.
Thank you.
Probably deported.
Good, time for just a couple more questions, unfortunately.
Okay, I'll try.
I'm just curious about your mom and how she may have helped you grow as an artist.
That's a great question, because she's entirely responsible for why I'm here. She cast me as the Wicked Witch of the West when I was 5. She greened me up, turned me into a girl, and trotted me out on stage in a production at the American Cathedral in Paris. And as a result of that, I just had this default thing of I would try and audition for school plays, which I would never have done, because it's just not me. So she's entirely responsible. She was an actress herself, and she's very proud of me, and I'm very grateful to her.
Hi, I was wondering if you've ever had any scary fan moments. Have anybody ever throw themselves at you?
I've signed a wedding cake for a couple who just got engaged, which I felt really wrong about. That was weird, with icing. I've been sent some things which, I don't know, sort of odd to send, and there's been some pretty scary things too, I've got to be honest, which I won't dwell on too much, but, you guys are great, like 99.999%, but there's the odd kooky 0.0001 that they try and have an effect on your life in whatever way they can, which is not always positive, but, you know, with the world in which we live, I'm not on Twitter, I'm not on Facebook, I'm not on any of those things. Actually, funny story, I've got to tell this story. I got this, and the reason why I'm not on those things is to sort of, because I'm quite a private person, and I love meeting you guys when it's face-to-face, but the internet world is, it's a scary place to be very prominent, I think. But the good side of it is, my wife got a tweet the other night from a friend, an old school friend of mine called Nick John, and she said, this guy's contacted you. My wife's never heard of him. You'll know him. Then I got an email from my agent in London saying, I just got an email from this guy who lives in Israel who's going to be in Phoenix and he needs to see you to have dinner. And it was Nick John. I said, yes, I actually do know who Nick is. So I arranged to meet him here. And then Nick said to me that 2 weeks ago he was Googling, which is Bradley Walsh word. Fracking Googleizer. He was looking up old school friends and seeing what had become of them. One of my great friends who became a rugby player, he was wondering, I wonder if he ever became a rugby player. And he suddenly thought, what about Jamie St. John Bamber Griffith, which is my full name? And he put my name in, and he had a heart attack, because he watched Battlestar for 5 seasons and did not even question for 1 second if he'd ever seen that guy before or sat next to him in English classes for 4 years. And he knew my full name, Jamie St. John Bamber Griffith, and the title Jamie Bam. It never made him think. And he had this moment, oh my God. He was in a room with some friends. This is too weird. You know Apollo? I know him. I sat next to him for 4 years. We were friends. We went to the same university. And then his friend, who was in the same room, said, you're going to Phoenix next week, aren't you? He said, yeah. He said, Jamie's going to be there at a convention. He said, I'm going to a convention in Phoenix. Yeah. He's going to be staying at the Hyatt opposite you in the shack. So I had dinner with Nick last night, and a week ago, he had no idea who I was.